Welcome to Retouch Pro Live. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Thank you for being with us today. Before we begin, my normal housekeeping, just so that everybody is on the same page. I saw a lot of new names in the registration link, so I want to welcome everyone. I want to show you how you can interact with us. You should see a screen looking similar to this. The important part is the questions line here. If you don't see this little panel here, you can click the arrow here, or it might be a plus sign depending on your operating system. Click that and this panel will drop down. You can type your question or comment here and hit send. And I will be scanning them throughout the show, and if there's something relevant, I will try to, as smoothly as possible, work it into our dialogue. And at the end of the show, if we have some time left over, we can just do a straight-ahead Q&A session. For the newcomers in the audience, let me show you RetouchPRO.com. I want to invite you to come visit us and check out our forums. We have forums for every conceivable topic, including photo restoration and retouching. While you are there, if you would do me the favor of checking out our rental videos, you go to the site nav menu, click on the videos link. It takes you to our rentals page. Here we have close to 100 videos, all of a minimum of 2 hours, some closer to 3 hours long. Everything from the absolute basic rudiments of Photoshop and Lightroom, all the way up to some truly hair-curlingly advanced topics. We have retouching, photo restoration, jewelry retouching, technical basics, printing, monitors, just about every topic you could possibly want. I'd appreciate it if you would check that out there. Also, while you're there, if you would do me the favor of consider becoming a patron. This is basically how we pay our server fees and pay for the webinars like that. This is essentially our tip jar, or our donation plea. So if you would check that out while you are there, that would be very, very kind of you. If you miss something, things might be going a little bit fast today. If you do miss something, don't worry. The entire show is being recorded and will be made available on YouTube sometime tomorrow. If you are viewing us now on YouTube, hi, welcome. Do me a favor and click the little thumbs up icon under the video window. And if you would also do me the favor of subscribing, that way you'll get notifications of future uploads. Let's see, I think I have all the housekeeping out of the way. It is my privilege every week here on Retouch Pro Live to be speaking with some of the most respected and talented industry experts. But today actually has me feeling a little bit giddy. This is my opportunity to interview a personal hero. This is something that I'm sure a lot of you share. I first became aware of Maggie's work, in the early 2000s as an offshoot of my interest in photo restoration. I started following her work, and I bought the Landscape of Dreams book by Amy Standen, which I can highly recommend. That is one of my favorite photo art books. I keep it on my shelf right next to my Edward Weston and Ansel Adams books. This is a little bit of a departure for us. We normally speak with working professionals and industry types. Maggie is a fine artist, and so there's going to be some interesting areas to get into today that we have not yet had a chance to explore on Retouch Pro Live, so I'm looking forward to that. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Maggie Taylor.
So now I start talking?
Now you start talking. You'll have to click the little OK button on your screen there so we can see your screen.
The thing that says show my screen.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you see my Photoshop?
Yes, we can. Welcome, welcome, Maggie.
Thank you. I'm a little nervous about this.
Oh, don't. No, hey, so am I. No, I've done well over a couple of hundred of these shows, but I was actually nervous today because I was not lying. You are one of the people that I really respect, that I really look forward to seeing your images. I mean, not that I don't look forward to seeing everybody's images, but it's different. You're in a different realm. Your stuff hangs in museums, for crying out loud.
Well, only once in a while, but basically I sit at home and just work on the computer.
It certainly hangs in museums more often than mine does. How's that?
Okay, I guess.
Now, you and I are going to chat here for a little while, and as I said in the introduction, I do invite the audience to type in their questions and comments while we're chatting. But just so that, you put together a little slideshow of some of your work just to give everybody something visual to concentrate on while you and I are yammering back and forth. Apologies to the audience for the watermark there. We might get into that a little bit in our discussion as to why that's there.
I know, it's kind of retarded looking, but they can...
you've actually got a fun anecdote behind that, so somebody in the audience remind me a little bit later on, we'll get into that. Now, apologies in advance for starting with such a banal and elementary question, but can you tell us all a little bit about your history and the path that got you into creating these surreal landscapes?
Well, I guess I was a photographic artist first. I got my degree in traditional film-based photography, and I worked in a color darkroom and made color still life images for about 10 years. So then, and also I got married to the person who was my teacher in graduate school, Jerry Yulesman, and then about 1995 or 96, the people from Photoshop asked him to make a poster with them and to work with Photoshop to check it out. So suddenly we had access to a good computer and a scanner and Photoshop. I think it was like version 2. And it was just, here at our house to play around with. And I started to teach myself how to do it. You know, I got the manual out and looked through it. You know, it was a small manual back then, so it only took part of an afternoon to read about the tool palettes and the, there were no layers back then. It was just the selection methods mostly.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved it just from the start. I mean, I wasn't sure what I could make with it, but I loved playing with it. It was like a video game to me. I never played any other video games, but I liked the Photoshop one.
It's a nice analogy. So your ambition from the get-go was to be a fine artist.
Yes. And so, I had been making color photographs and sending them off to a few galleries that showed them or, entering juried exhibitions and that kind of stuff back in the late 80s, early 90s. And it had been going all right. You know, I definitely felt happy with what I was doing with the camera and film, but this opened up a whole different realm for me where it was much more fun. I mean, like, I could really invent whatever I wanted to. Like, so much of the time I was kind of disappointed with what I got on film, and I would think, I don't like the shadow, I don't like something about that image, just isn't quite right, and then I'd have to go back and reshoot it again.
Mm-hmm.
So the computer just made everything possible, and I could like spend days and days or weeks and weeks on one image. Yeah. And it was also kind of cheap back then because I didn't have a fancy digital camera, and I was just kind of using a scanner and putting objects and old photos and stuff right on the scanner and then just playing with them. And like at first the people from galleries weren't so interested in it because they were like, I don't know about an inkjet print, I'm not sure if we'd want to show that. But eventually people came around and the technology got better, the paper and the inks and so on became more stable,
so the times had to catch up with you.
Yeah, and then I basically never went back to the camera. Like, I realized I didn't like the darkroom that much anyway. I'm sorry to all those people who love it, including my husband, but, I never liked the chemicals, and I never liked the process for color photography that much.
I never cared for the color darkroom, but I must admit I do miss Dektal. Now, I can't recall. I don't think I've ever seen any of your straight photography. What did it look like? How did it compare with what you're doing nowadays? Could you see foreshadowing of your eventual style in that?
You probably could, because there were all kinds of odd little objects that I would take outside and set up in these little tableaus in my yard and photograph them. Mm-hmm. And some of them are the same objects I use now. I like stuff. Like, I have drawers full of stuff, and I have my favorite little things.
And bric-a-brac and things along those lines?
Exactly. So some of it is the same now as it was then. Or, you know, somewhat similar. I like to go to flea markets and
I was just thinking, I bet you're fun to go to with a flea market.
Yeah. Except I wouldn't be talking to you at the flea market. I'd just be looking for my own stuff.
Well, that's okay. I would be standing up at the side going, ooh, ah, watching you work. Was there a moment, or was there an event or whatever that after you'd found Photoshop that, you know, you said, hey, there's these old photos and here's a flatbed scanner. Well, I mean, I'm trying to find the point on the continuum where your modern style crystallized.
I don't know if I could exactly pinpoint that, but I'd say between like 1995 and 2000, I was just kind of experimenting with things with the computer. Mm-hmm. And then starting in about 2000, I still have some images that I mean, there's some images from 2000 on that I still show people that I'm not totally embarrassed by. So, you know, but it was an organic kind of thing, just the stuff that I liked and the way that it worked on the scanner. And using the 19th century photographs just kind of evolved over time, I guess. And now I collect a lot of them.
I'm worried that I'm going to be embarrassed I even asked this, but was there any sort of financial or technical reason why you started working with old photos? I mean, it guarantees you don't have to no licensing fees, and you don't have to worry about wrangling models around and all. It just seems to me to be an ideal situation.
Well, you know, it wasn't for the copyright reason, no, but it was just basically that I loved the way that they looked. And Jerry had some old photographs, and I had a few. He had more than I did. And I had a few that I'd bought at flea markets and antique stores, and I had tried to use them in my old still life photographs, but it never really worked out very well because you'd have this odd rectangle plop down in the middle of another image. So I really loved the way that they looked, and when I realized that they scanned so nicely, and then I could blow them up and do whatever I wanted with them, it became a better way for me to include people in my work. I never photographed people at all. Like, with a camera, I think the whole reason I was making still life images is that I have just never been comfortable going out into the world and photographing people with a camera.
Are you an introvert?
Yes, and I like people to be – that's why I'm freaked out about talking to all these random people on this conference call for however many people it is.
Don't worry about it. I'm also an introvert, and that's one of the reasons I invented this format. We can talk and talk and talk, but nobody can see us.
Yes, exactly. I'm here, like, wringing my hand as I'm talking to you. But, you know, I don't want to photograph people, and so I want people in my work. So how can I get these, like, actors to be in my work? Well, use old photographs, and it works.
Now, this is something I plan on getting to later, but I've already got a couple of questions on this. Where do you find your old photographs?
Well, sometimes on eBay, although I find I can waste an awful lot of time if I get sucked into like an eBay morning. If I've got my cup of coffee and I go on there, you know, I'll think, oh, Maggie, just give yourself 10 minutes on eBay. And then like an hour and a half later, I'm still on there. So that can be a big time waste. But I have gotten some absolutely incredible things on eBay. In the last few months, I got something for like $80 that's the most gorgeous half-plate daguerreotype that I've ever seen. It's really beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I can't believe that someone sold it for that, but I got it. So you never know. There are treasures out there. And then I go in person, you know, wherever I can, to antique stores. You know, if I'm driving up to Savannah or I'm going to visit my mother in South Florida, I'll just stop in places and see if there might be something.
Just a little,
or, you know, a flea market too.
A little tip for the audience from my own personal experience. If you go to eBay and you type in your search term, whatever it is, tintype or old photos or vintage photos is actually one of the most common terms out there. But if you add the word lot at the end of that, that's what I used to do whenever I was looking for practice photos for my photo restoration or whatever. And you will get people that have a box of 50 or 100 or 200 or one time it was even 1,000 old photos, and they sell it for next to nothing because they have it. And I'm not saying that you're going to be able to do something in the realm like Maggie does, but if you're looking for stuff just to practice or just a pile of stuff to browse through or whatever, just add the word lot to your eBay description. Now, do you always scan your own photos? Nowadays, it's 2015. We've got all these wonderful the Library of Congress archive with all their multi-gigabyte scans of old Matthew Brady photos or whatever. You never do anything like that?
For the most part, I prefer to have the original of the image here, whether it's a tintype or an ambrotype or a daguerreotype. I like having the thing. It just is part of the karma for me, I guess. Mm-hmm. But every once in a while, if I need a small element for something, I will go online and look. You know, if I need to know let's say I need like a glass, I'll go on the Crate and Barrel website and look for a glass, something like that. But for the most part, I don't do the internet stuff. And the few times I've tried it, last year I tried to download some patterns of Victorian wallpaper, and I swear 2 days later my Visa card was stolen. So it was one of those things that was like, I knew that was too good to be
true. That's a rite of passage, yes. Mm-hmm. So does it always start for you with an image, or do you come up with something in your head and then you look for a photograph or an image that fits that?
It starts usually with an image, with a person, and from there I can, you know, start playing around with it and see what might happen. If you want, I'll show you, like, for this, the one, you know, that little image that I just showed at the very end there, mm-hmm. that was this girl, right? Mm-hmm. You can see that. I can show you for her what she started with.
Sure.
And kind of explain how that came about. The heat just came on in my house. It's really loud. I hope that doesn't bother the sound.
Can't hear a thing.
Good. I usually start with just scanning things in that I like and retouching them. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, through that process, which can take me a couple of days usually, I'll kind of come up with something that I might want to try for the image. But I don't start with like a sketch or totally preconceived idea. It just doesn't seem to work that way for me. Mm-hmm. So like in this case, I had this brother and sister image that I thought were really wonderful, although the boy wasn't as interesting to me as the girl. So sometimes I'll separate people. And in her case, I decided she fit the bill of something I wanted to make for a potential future Alice in Wonderland type image. Mm-hmm. So this is actually the retouched version of this image. And I didn't save the totally unretouched version. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. This is an example of something that's like when I've just scanned it in, mm-hmm. and you can see how horrible it is, right? But I like this lady's background, and I like some aspects of her gloves and her dress, but I wouldn't use her face because she's moved during the long exposure. Mm-hmm. So with this, what I would do is just start retouching. It's the same thing I did with that other image. And so, like, really, it's the most boring thing in the world, but I kind of enjoy it. So I'll just sit there and zoom in and take what I call the Band-Aid tool, you know, and just start Band-Aiding away. Or, you know, if I get bored with Band-Aid after a while, I'll take the rubber stamp tool and put it on darken and go and get rid of all these. But it's a many hours kind of process, you know.
Now, whenever you get these from eBay or wherever, sometimes, you know, I've done it, and they're like in a frame, or sometimes they're actually end up being like bent in a semicircle or whatever. I mean, do you actually, since you know that this is just a raw material, do you ever actually like unframe them or bend them or things along those lines?
I take them out completely. So like this lady is a daguerreotype, and I took her out of her frame. And then, you know, once she's completely out, you can see that there's a place where the metal mat had left its kind of imprint. You know, it's sort of a staining thing that happened, a patina that happened from the metal mat that was on top of her. And she's pretty small. She's like 2.5 inches tall. But I love this aspect of it, the shape of that frame she was in. And, you know, in the end, I don't know what I will ever do with her. I might not do anything with her. Haven't done anything with her yet. But I like this outer area, and I'll definitely use that for something. So I need to, like, retouch the whole thing, and I'll spend a long, long time on that.
Okay.
And I don't mind.
Do you have, like, the world's best scanner or something?
No, I have I have two different ones right now. I have an Epson Perfection V750 that I've had for quite a number of years. It's, you know, not that fancy. I got it at Best Buy or Circuit City or something. And then I have an Epson 10,000 XL that I don't use as much, but it can scan larger things. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit older, but it can scan, you know, a bigger thing. Can go on there like 11 by 14 tabloid size or something.
How do you handle, like, some of these can be very reflective?
They're not really. Weirdly, when you put a daguerreotype, which is so silvery, right on the scanner, there's no reflection.
Okay.
One thing I've noticed is you should not press them down. If you press it down onto the scanner, you'll get Newton rings. That sort of small moiré pattern will happen. Yeah. So, yeah. Anyway, so I don't have any sort of magic tips for retouching, and I just find it kind of relaxing to sit there and do it. And I always scan things in 16-bit mode, so I scan at the best quality that my scanner can do, and then I do the retouching on the 16-bit file. So this is like a 275-megabyte file or something, and I would do all the retouching on it before I resize it or do anything else, you know. I'd sit here and get rid of every single one of these little dust specks.
What sort of resolution are we working at here?
I usually work at 360 DPI.
Okay.
I have no idea right this second what this file is. I just pulled it out of nowhere.
360?
Yeah, it's 360, but it's like 17 by 21 inches.
Okay.
And in the end, most of my work, I work at 15 inches, so I probably would, for her, I would eventually make her a little bit smaller or crop her.
So you find an image that inspires you. You obtain it however you're going to obtain it. You scan it, you clean it up, and then...
And then, like, so this is the point at which, all right, I've spent days already maybe cleaning this up, and I've gotten it so that I'm really happy with the way that they look. And even if I zoom in, I mean, you'd see there's still some problems with him, but I'm really kind of more focused on her, knowing that I might want to get rid of him, so he still has, you know, a few little issues that could be fixed up. Yeah, he's kind of not so appealing looking to me. And the color in this right now is just from the scan of the daguerreotype, so there's no other color added yet. Sometimes the kids or the people will have a little bit more pinkish skin, or they'll have some gold on their rings or something like that, or even a dress color.
They would hand dye them back then sometimes.
Yeah, they would hand color them, but this one didn't have anything. So then what I would have to do is cut her out, because basically even though I might use this background, I want her completely separate from the background. Mm-hmm. So I usually just do like a really rough cutout first with the lasso tool. And I've kind of learned over the years the things I like and don't like. I don't like people's chairs behind them. So I tend to cut out the chairs, because if I wanted a chair, I could make one myself. And
have you ever seen any of those freaky old images where they've got the mom actually standing next to the child, but they've got her like a blanket over her or whatever, so that she's just there?
Oh, yeah, the hidden mother.
Yeah, she's just there to calm the baby or whatever, it actually ends up looking like a ghost standing next to the baby or whatever.
Yeah, like a ghost hidden mother. Some people collect those. So in this case, like, I knew that I wanted her, and I wanted her hand just in case I want to try to use that hand for something else. Mm-hmm. I mean, I might move it much closer than it was, but I put that on a separate layer. And then, there's no, like, magic instant fix to get her away from the background. Sometimes I use the little quick selection tool, or sometimes I use the mask. I'm not the most technical person in the world.
Mm-hmm. Just whatever works.
See? Yeah, and if I'm trying something and it's not working, the thing I'll often go to is just simply putting a mask on her and sitting there with a paintbrush that has a kind of hard edge and going around the whole woman and just, you know,
okay.
getting rid of everything. Very boring, but I like it.
You ever use the pen tool?
No, I think that pen tool is the work of the devil. I never used
I
the pen
knew
tool.
There was a reason I liked you.
You know, on a rare occasion, if someone's forearm is looking real lumpy, I might try the pen tool, but it always puts me in a bad mood. So I sit here and do it like this, you know, with a mask and eraser and everything, and it's very, very boring.
Just old school.
Sometimes you'll get to a certain part of the image where you actually can use the, like if I wanted to try again just to select her dress, I could try maybe, because where you have a collar that's a different color from the dress, oh yeah, so that's working a little bit better. That's that quick selection tool. I never know if it's really going to cooperate with me or not, so I don't do one big quick selection. If you see my history palette over here, you'll see I do a whole bunch of different quick selections.
Yeah.
Because if one of them goes awry, then I don't want to have to completely back
up. Well, it's actually kind of tough on a monochrome image because there's a whole realm of information that it does not have available to do its magic on.
Right. So, you know, I can get kind of an okay selection of the dress. And then let's say I already had her cut out more decently than that. Well, I could select the inverse. Normally, I don't show everything else behind my Photoshop either. I work like this, where, you know, where I'm not showing everything else. And then I could. I don't use a whole lot of shortcuts.
Mm-hmm.
Some, you know, there's some of the tools I know the shortcut for that's easy, but for the most part, I'm not a big shortcut person. And you get your favorite tools while you're working. You know, I love the lasso tool. I love the magic wand, actually, still. I know everybody else probably loves the quick selection tool, but, you know, and I can select the inverse. And when I want to start making, like, a color for her dress, usually I'll just do a new layer. And I try to name my layers, but I'm not always so good at that.
Mm-hmm.
So this will be her dress color. And I'll just pick a whatever kind of color, neutral, nice blue. And then I would have worked a little harder to make sure that the selection for the dress was a little more fine than that, because I probably would have zoomed all the way in and checked everything and stuff. But, you know, like that, and then I can just set it to a color layer. But I never leave it at 100% because that would make it look so flat. Mm-hmm. And so I usually cut it way down to, like, something between 50 and 60%, sometimes less, and just have it be a color layer like that. And then I can add a hue and saturation adjustment layer to it that's linked with that color layer. And so that'll be my way that I can change her dress color. And as I'm continuing to work on the image, I could try a whole bunch of different colors.
Okay.
So
Feather would like to know if you use a pen or just your mouse.
I use a pen. If you could see me right now, I have one of those Wacom, however you say it, a tablet with a pen.
Okay.
I don't love the mouse that much. Everything else in the world I do with the mouse, but when I'm in Photoshop, I only use the pen.
Okay.
Yeah. And then I would do the same thing, like, for her skin color and everything. I would make a separate layer, just like I did for the dress color, and do skin color, and I would do hair color, and so on.
Now, do you have any tricks for skin? I know that's, like, the hardest area. Do you have, like, any preset palettes you use or anything, or is it all just eyeball?
It's just pretty much the eyeball, you know. Like, I have found that people's parts in their hair, you have to kind of go up into that part, because if you didn't do it up into the hair, like, the hair and the skin have to kind of share a little bit of overlap,
mm-hmm.
sort of, for it to look normal. But that's not even a very good selection there, but I would just make a new layer and call it skin color. And then I usually just get the color picker and pick a kind of what I think might be a kind of skin color, because you can change it later.
Mm-hmm.
And I fill it, that little thing, and then I change it to a color layer, and I cut it way down, because if the person in the original photograph had any color in their skin at all, I for sure would want that to show through.
Mm-hmm.
if they don't, then, like this girl doesn't really have anything, then I still don't want it to be 100%, because I don't know, the 100% just looks too flat to me. So something in the middle. And then, you know, I would just sit there and take an eraser and get rid of the part that I don't want that's going on to her hair a little bit too much. And then once I had it all sort of fine-tuned around the edges and stuff with just an eraser, basically, I add an adjustment layer to that to tweak the color a little bit. I was going to say twerk the color, but that's a different thing.
Now, yeah, that'd be an interesting show.
Twerking the color.
Now, is the,
so, it, like that.
I'm assuming at some point you go in and add other colors?
I'll add colors for every single little thing, whatever I can think of. So I'll add color for the eyes and color for the lips and color for the hair and color for the collar and any other aspect of the clothing. Yeah, each one will have its own thing.
What about variations within a color? Do you do that on another layer or the same layer?
Usually I do it as an adjustment layer. So if I decided I wanted, because I'm always changing my mind, so like if I wanted her cheeks to be more, you know, whatever, I would just make a hue and saturation adjustment layer that's a separate one, and I would make it, say, more saturated or more pinkish, and then I would fill it with black, and then come in with an eraser, and maybe just erase where I wanted it to be.
Really, about the only technical thing I think we need to underscore for the audience is that you are clipping, are clipping all of those layers.
Yes, those are together so that that hue and saturation layer would only affect her skin color. Yeah.
Okay, now
and then that would just be too much.
Assuming you were really working on this and you'd spent all the time to make it look wonderful, etc., but you were still at this particular point. Do you have an inkling in your mind at this point that you want her holding a fish or standing under an umbrella or something at this point?
Oh, not so much. Usually I'm just kind of thinking what options would there be, and a lot of it depends on where I've been recently, what I've done recently, if I've collected something recently that I really like, you know. I have a thing that I can show you in Bridge here that shows for her kind of how that happened over time. Do you want to see that?
Yes, please.
So this was like after I colored her, and I had to renegotiate the whole situation with her arm. So I took that hand, and you can see kind of over here in this bigger thumbnail, I had to take her hand and smoosh it over there and make a duplicate of the other arm and sort of make it a little different, but make it so that she had two.
And also, we had another question. Somebody wanted to know about the boy's hand, and that was another thing that you did to get rid of the boy's hand.
Yeah, I got rid of the boy's hand and just filled in with more fabric, like cloning or whatever, from the other side of her dress. And that happens a lot. People are not, like, posed in the exact way you want. They're leaning on a table or something. You have to maybe copy half of their body and flip it. So this, like, already to get to that point would take, days and days.
Sure.
Not, like, that's not something I would do in one day by any means. And then I started trying different backgrounds for her. And in this case, I sort of knew that I wanted her to be an Alice in Wonderland thing that I was kind of working on. Mm-hmm. So I wanted her to have something to do with a boat or water, but I wasn't totally sure. And I tried these, I don't know if you probably can't see because it's quite small, but she's got tears there that are kind of...
I saw something. I didn't know what it was, but yeah, okay.
Yeah, she's got little tears there, but then I decided that was too odd. So I tried different backgrounds. That's actually New York City in the background. And this is a background with more fog on the trees. And then I thought, well, I could add water back there. So that's, this was just a foresty fog background. This is a river background. And then I liked that, so I thought, well, I'll stay with the water. And I put a little bee in there. There's a small little sort of insect there. Uh-huh. And the flower is just on the scanner. That's a zinnia or what, a mum, I guess it is, on the scanner. And then, you know, over time I tried a couple different things that didn't work. That's what usually happens is you're working and then something, you know, just is too off. You've tried too many things. And that's when you know you have to kind of back off and change and
so
eliminate.
So, like, for example, in this one here, you're working on it. Do you actually say in your mind, I wonder what would happen if she was holding an oar, or do you just happen to have a folder with a picture of it, it's in an oar and it catches your eye, or you just happen to have that on your... I'm trying to just figure out the process.
Well, I wanted her to have something else to have to do with the river or the water, and I opened up my little drawer of objects and realized I had an oar. It's like just a little
okay.
5-inch long wooden oar, like a souvenir, 19th century souvenir oar sort of thing. So I scanned it. Actually, I have two of them. So this is one, and this is a different one. And I decided, well, I sort of like the thinner one better. But then I showed it to Jerry. Sometimes I'll email stuff to Jerry, and he'll look at it for me. And he said, that oar is stupid. So the oar is out of there. No more oar. And then I decided, well, then a boat. So this is a toy boat, which looks kind of totally out of place at first. But by the time you put shadow under it and everything, then it was kind of okay. And then I thought more and different flowers would be good. But I went kind of overboard, I think, with these wild kind of weedy flowers. And then what else? This sort of process, though, goes on for a couple weeks usually. That was zooming in to show she had better looking tears there, I guess.
Now, do you work on one image and then stop and work on another image, or during those days or weeks or whatever, are you only working on this one image?
Yeah, I'm usually working on like two images lately, it seems like. There could be three or four that are halfway done or partway done, and then if I'm frustrated with it, I'll leave it. Like actually in this one, what I do is I make screenshots as I'm working just to have a record of how it's changed, because sometimes it helps me over time to go back and look at that. So what's in this whole folder you're seeing in Bridge here, these are screenshots made as I was actually working on it. So, you know, these are from 2014, January 18th. So this is from last year, and then you see it jumps to 2014, April 8th. So there was a long time between January 23rd and April 8th where I didn't even work on this image because I was kind of frustrated with it and not that happy with it. And then I sort of left it off at that point and then came back and added the oar and was not that happy with that. And then during the course of like the next few days, was able to kind of finish it up.
No, that's something interesting. Those are screenshots. Those are not actually versions of the file. This is something you do for all of your images. You actually take screenshots of your progress.
Yeah, because two reasons. I mean, I don't want to save a version at the end of every day. That would be just, these are huge files. It would be too much to keep. So I save a screenshot because I can have that to show kind of how it progressed, and I can email them to Jerry. So I'll email him like here's two different things. Do you like it better with the extra grass with white flowers? Do you like it extra grass with no flowers or something like that? Or I can say, do you like her with three tiers or just two tiers? So, you know, they're just useful for me. I do, along the way, I do back up and I save, you know, a couple of versions with all their full size and many layers along the way. But mostly I like saving these screenshots.
Do you have like terabytes of hard drives laying around?
Sort of, yeah.
They're all neatly labeled so that if you ever wanted to, say, that toy boat image again 3 years later, you would know exactly where it was, or is that not an issue for you?
Not so much. I can find things if I need them, but I'm not really that organized.
Okay, so you pretty much work on the image you're working on, and nothing else, you're not really concerned about any other image. And in the future, you're working on another image, so you start with other new sources. You don't ever have to think, well, there was an image I used back in 2008, and it was the perfect flower for this, or I don't know.
Yeah, you know, I save everything with layers, though, so if I liked her flower in the end, after I've done all the work to it, I could go back and get it. You know, so I do save them with layers, always.
Teresa wanted to know, how do you scan a toy boat? But I guess that there's a larger theme there of what other ways do you have of bringing images into your files?
Well, yeah, so some things don't scan very well, and you can try scanning them, and it doesn't work very well. So in that case, I took that toy boat and put it on a mirror outside on my patio table and took a picture of it with a little point-and-shoot camera. Mm-hmm. And more I've noticed I'm just kind of using my cell phone camera because it's quick and easy, and I can email it to myself. But, you know, I can, because the cell phone camera is pretty good. So I'll just, if it's too big, if it's an umbrella or something big like that.
Are we getting close to the day when there's a Maggie Taylor filter on our Instagram?
I think not. Let's hope not. I'll show you, though, in here, there was another, this was another thing from last year that shows that. This, in my studio, I have just a bunch of objects that kind of inspire me or that I like, right? So this on the right here is like, actually in my studio, it's a big painted folk arty panel that's like a thing I bought at an antique store. I don't have any idea who painted it or anything, but it's just a weird panel, and I like that it's garden-looking.
Looks like a Magritte.
And in front of it, yeah, it does. It has this pointillist Surratt kind of thing to it. So in front of it, I have a little penguin and a doll that just kind of hang out over there. And one day I walked in the studio and I thought, you know, I never have photographed her and I like her. So I took her outside and just did, you know, this is like, I don't really prepare. I am not a studio photographer. I literally walked out my back door and put her there. And you can see the back door is open there and I haven't even cleaned off the ground. I'm not really thinking ahead about making it easier for myself to cut her out or whatever. And then I thought, well, her dress looks stupid. It's so flat. So I had to stuff some paper towels up under it to make it more poofy. And I'm just trying, you know, and then I'll come inside and look at these because they're just with my, either my point-and-shoot little, like, Canon camera or with my cell phone camera. And then I realized I could do better because, you know, I want to get better light and better detail. So this is the full extent of my studio setup outside when I photograph. This is on my patio table underneath a green umbrella, which I'm not even paying attention to the fact that I have this big green umbrella, but I take a couple of pieces of insulation that have a kind of silvery thing to them because I think maybe it will add
something.
That's
wonderful because I was thinking those are, you know, expensive studio fill light or fill reflectors or whatever.
No, they're pretty minimal. But and then I just tried different angles until I finally liked, I think that was the one that I liked. So then I come in and cut her out and started playing with it, you know, a couple different versions of her. And this is what I first envisioned. I took the actual a photograph of that actual background thing and I added in some clouds and I thought maybe it'll be like that. And I was thinking of her as this sleepwalker. But then as I started working on it, I really realized I didn't like that background. So pretty quickly I switched and she had a totally different background that was a different image I had been working on of a tree that I made as a drawing. Sometimes I just do these little doodle things.
Sure.
And so, you know, I just tried different things. So I tried different backgrounds with her. This was my first attempt maybe of the doodle drawing. And I put legs from another old photograph in there. So, you know, as time went on, I tried, you know, all different options for how she could interact with the tree. But that really is just like that, that girl there is from just the point-and-shoot snapshot in the yard.
Fascinating.
Went on and on and on. At one point, I wanted to see what lightning bugs look like, so I went on the web and downloaded a picture of a lightning bug, thinking maybe I'd use that, but it wasn't exactly what I wanted. So I made my own just abstract glowy lightning bugs. And then I decided if I compared with or without lightning bug, I decided I actually kind of liked it better without. So that was like a whole wasted day of lightning bug research and making bugs. And now she's the finished, after she was blue and green and every other color, finally I decided I liked the pinkish version better, where she's real glowy like that. So that was the finished version of
this
it.
This is marvelous. This is like the rightest brain creative process I've ever witnessed. It's marvelous.
Marvelous.
Now, we're getting close to the 45-minute mark here, and we promised everybody that you would actually walk through the layer stack of this image.
Yes. So this is the background layer with my lovely watermark.
Yeah. Let's tell the watermark story to let everybody know.
Well,
because this is not, I think this is fascinating from a professional point of view.
Okay. Well, when you asked me about doing this, I said I was just concerned about you're going to put this on YouTube and what if people can steal screen captures of the files kind of big.
And I'm like, who cares? You know, so what? It's YouTube.
Yeah. And the thing is, in the last year or so, people have – it's happened a couple different times. People in China have been making and selling refrigerator magnets of my work. And God knows where they're getting these files. I don't know. But I just don't want to make it easy for people.
Yeah. And it's not going to help you with the Chinese magnet people. But if you ever did need to go to court or something or whatever, it's not that the water – I need to stress this for people. Watermarks are not bulletproof protection for your images or whatever. But they are an indication that you made an effort. Okay? And that's really all the courts care about. So that
you probably could get rid of it really easily with just the the
Yeah, but like I say, it is not there as a bulletproof copyright protection. It is there as an indication of intent from the artist that you did not want to share this image. So there can be no misunderstanding. There can be no one can say, but I thought she wanted to put this into public domain later on. You know? So, I know it's a major trauma for you, and I really, really apologize, but I get tickled pink thinking about all these Chinese guys making magnets out of your images.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for the Schadenfreude there, but but the fact that they like it so much, and it's such an incongruous thing that these Victoriana Gothic looking surreal portraiture that you do, and these Chinese tinkerers are ripping them off. It's just
it is kind of bizarre.
So anyway, that's why we have the watermarks.
Yeah. So here's what exists in this image. There's a woods in the background. It's really faded out, so you're only seeing it, you know, at 74% or whatever it is, the woods there. And then that is, I know that it's on top of the girl, and that's okay with me. I make a mask so that the woods can't go into the outer part of the image here, but the woods is just from a snapshot of actual woods that I took. And then I have layers that adjust some of the color, and I have a layer that's this watery background. And if you looked at the watery background all by itself, it's just a snapshot I took of a local river. Mm-hmm. That's what it is, just a scene, and it's got some grass in it, which that's where it sort of suggested to me that maybe I wanted to put real grasses in her arms, that would look kind of interesting. And I'm not worried that it's over the top of her because I already cut her out. Remember, like from before, I cut the girl out so that I can have the freedom to move her wherever
I'm going
to
pause you there because I can see in her dress distinctly two different shades of green. Where did that come in?
Okay, so she has, let's see, what does she have? She's got all kinds of different little layers here for her smile and her skin. Sometimes they have two layers for their skin because sometimes the skin is so pale that you have to kind of darken it down a little bit. So I've got a color layer and a multiply layer that's only set at 12% that kind of darkens down her skin a little bit. So then on the dress, what it is I have actually on the layer that is the color for her dress, it's set to multiply, but it's made with a gradient.
So I just took
the gradient editor and did it from green to a yellow green on there.
Fascinating.
No, I lied. That's not the way I did it. Look, it's a hue and saturation adjustment layer. So if you look at just her dress, actually, I filled it all with brown. Sometimes I do use the gradient color thing, but I didn't in this case. It's an all brown, and then I've taken a hue and saturation adjustment layer and done it with the mask. You see that?
You alt-click on that mask?
Yeah. Alt-click? Yeah. What's an alt?
Option.
Oh.
Sorry.
I'm a Mac person. Yes. If I turn the mask off...
There, one more. There we go.
That's what you want.
That's
to
what
see?
I wanted to see to demystify because they look a lot nicer and more elegant as thumbnails, and if we blow them up there, we can see how rough and ready they really are.
Yeah, you know, I just wanted to make sure that the upper part of her dress stayed more, you know, whatever. So, and I probably already have messed up this whole image, so I definitely won't save it the way it is. Let's see what else. I use a lot of adjustment layers to darken certain areas. So this is like just to darken down her dress. And then that's like to indicate where water maybe hit her dress or something like that.
Sure.
And if I wanted it even darker, you know, once I made a print, I could darken it even more. I can make it really black. Just I like to leave the option there so that by the time I'm making a test print, I can still change things. And her collar was way too white. That was her original collar. Mm-hmm. So I made it a layer to kind of darken that down a little bit. And then sometimes the people have still kind of rough edges by the time I'm done with them. So in this case, I decided that she needed a mask. So I'll just put a mask over the whole, girl to make it have sort of smoother edges. Like I'll select the girl and then use a smooth thing in the selection and then, you know, like that.
Are you a fan of refine edge?
Yeah, with the smoothing.
Okay.
Sometimes. Yeah. And just because it makes the people look less lumpy if you can. And you also could use a path tool, I'm sure, but I just don't like the, or the pen tool. You could make a path. I just don't do that. And then I add selectively little bits of water too, like in the lower left, I wanted a little more reflective water, so I tried putting in just a partially transparent piece of another lake there. And then they have tons of layers, but that gives me flexibility to go back and work on them. Mm-hmm. So like the boat itself is actually just on a layer like that. Mm-hmm. And I've got a little mask to kind of mask it a little on the edge so it appears to be underwater. Sometimes I use smart objects. For some reason I didn't with that boat. If I were doing this again today, I probably would try to make the boat be a smart object just to be sure that I could resize it as many times as I wanted mm-hmm. without it falling apart, you know. And then all my little flowers. I try to use these folders to keep things in just because it does simplify it a little bit. But, like, you know, the actual little flowers are just scanned, mm-hmm. just on the scanner. If something can go on the scanner, I put it on the scanner. It's easy. And then there's a little bee, and her tears are on a separate layer. Sometimes I draw things in Photoshop, so the tears are just kind of drawn in. Wonder what other one I was going to show you that I have. Oh, this is a good one if we still have time.
Your time is our time is your whatever. We got as much time as you want.
I thought it was like really normally people expected it to be an hour.
I promise an hour, and I want to make sure we cover all the key points in an hour, but after that, it's however long you want to be here.
This is
jaw-dropping. This is gorgeous. I haven't seen this one. This is marvelous.
Yeah, so this one starts with just a plain background that is actually taken from an old tintype, but I've erased the person who was in it, and it was kind of a lot of work to get that far, but you can sort of see there's ripples in the top that are the canvas backdrop
sure.
from an old tintype, and then it's kind of really worked over, but I love this background, and I've used it a whole bunch of times, and then I can put other stuff on top of it. I can add different edges, and I can add hue and saturation adjustment layers to sort of give it like a sky and a grass thing. So that's like the background. And I don't start with the background. I usually start with the person, right? Mm-hmm. But this is just to give you an idea of what's in the layer stack here. Because there's kind of two ways of looking at these things. You can look at the layer stack or you can look at my screenshots over time of how it happened. But in the layer stack, there's, you know, some grass layer. It's actually just kind of grass. And a few clouds to give some little clouds in the background. And the clouds, you know, usually I like overlay blend mode a lot, but if you looked at the clouds like 100%, they're really just kind of clouds where I've gone in and erased a bunch of them. And then when possible now, I do use smart objects. So, yeah, this girl is a smart object because I took every individual fern and put it in there on her dress. And
are those scans again?
Yeah, these are every single one is a scan of a fern from my yard. And so
marvelous. If,
underneath there's moss. That's just a sure. moss from my sister's yard actually. And it's actually just a really bad snapshot where I've cloned in where some stepping stones were. But that just gives a background so that there wouldn't be other stuff showing through where I didn't want it, you know? Just because like and then each individual fern is a layer, and I put each one on there. And each one has also usually an adjustment layer. And by making it a smart object, I can change the overall size of the girl if I want to, you know, or the dress. She's not really a girl yet. But so every single, this is one that has hundreds of layers because of how many ferns there were. And I started with it and made like 20 or 50 fern scans. And then I thought, no, I've got to have more. And I want each one to be different. I didn't want to just morph them.
Like you're a mad scientist. More.
Yeah, I didn't. Like it just bothered me to think that I have a whole yard full of ferns. So why would I, you know, why not go get a different one? Why make a copy of one? So anyway, and they're not well layered. That's the only frustrating thing. When I work like this, you got, you know, they're just numbers, layer
sure.
43, layer 42, layer 44 with its drop shadow. And each one that would need a drop shadow onto the things below it has it. So by the end, like, so that's every single fern that's in there. If you really looked at them, there's like 170 ferns or something in that dress, with smaller ones on the top and better ones down below. And if you really zoomed in and saw them, They're really nice
Just
ferns.
marvelous. Now, was the ferns your inspiration for this image, or was this ferns that was your afterthought?
I wanted to do a dress that was organic, and I'd done the thing before a long time ago that's a bee dress. And I've done a butterfly wing dress before a long time ago. And so I just had this thought that I wanted to do something, a garden image where the woman is kind of anchored to the ground with ferns. And actually, at first, I started scanning some leaves from outside, and then I didn't like them as much. And I thought, well, the ferns are a lot more interesting. And, I live in Florida, so we have a huge variety of them. So that was pretty much the idea. And then I didn't have a head for her. So if I show her in bridge, this is where so that was the layer stack version of hers. But if you look at the time lapse kind of thing, here in the beginning, I actually had a white canvassy background, and I started pasting the different ferns on there to the point where I got kind of like that far and realized, well, it's a sort of strapless fern dress. And then I thought maybe it doesn't even need any body. But then I thought I want a head, so I had to try some different heads on her. And for a while I thought she could have these kind of deer behind her, like these ghost things. And that was with a different head, which was kind of ugly. So then I got straps on the dress, but I still have the deer. And this goes on for a while. And then I thought I liked this head, which I've used before in my bee dress image. So she was in there for a while, and I tried,
Now, are
these are my.
were the hands on her face in the scans, or did you put them there?
No, they're my hands, so they're separate. Like those are two different photographs of my own
Oh,
arms.
okay.
And so I placed them in front of her in different ways. And I sort of liked it like that with this foggy background. But those are not meant to be the real deer. Those are meant just like as placeholders. Like I just went on the internet and downloaded images of white deer from
They do look
Google
a little
and put them in
Christmassy.
there. Yeah, to see if I like the idea sort of thing, And then I don't want to commit a whole lot of time to it unless I think I like them. So then I decided I like them. And I got Paul Caponigro's wonderful running white deer as my model there. And I thought, well, I want to make my own brown running deer. How would they look? So I cobbled together from an old etching that I have that I bought on eBay a deer. It's not the real way he looks, but I, tried to work with him and make him be running deer in the background, either black running deer or white running deer. But they were just kind of sad looking, my deer. And those were the brown. And then I showed it to Jerry, and he just kind of laughed, and he was like, whatever. But I'm like so excited because the dress looks great at that point.
Does.
I was real happy with the dress. And I like this girl, this head for her and my hands. So in the end, I decided I just liked just two deer is enough. Just that, don't overload the deer. And I also tried it with hardly any background like that, because at some point you reach a point where you're like, I don't know if I'm done with this image, but I need to explore some more options,
How
basically.
do you know when you're
Yeah.
done? When you're out of ideas, or do you ever see it and go, it's
Yeah,
done?
when you start trying really stupid things like the rabbit on her head. No, it's very hard to know. Here she had a rabbit on her head and a wishbone and a magnifying glass in the foreground. It's like you just add too many things, or a glass of water or milk. After a while, it's like, yeah, I think I need to back off a little bit and make a print and just live with it for a while and see what I really like in it, And then when I get to the point where I can hardly tell the difference between them, that's when I know that I'm done.
Okay.
So in her case, like toward the end of this whole process, I'm still playing a little bit with the background, but toward the end, the difference between the last few was so subtle, like I could hardly tell the difference between that one and that one. There's hardly any difference. And then I added one with blue gloves. That was like a last afterthought thing, and I decided, no, I don't really, the blue gloves are too distracting. Although I'd like to use that for another image, because the way the blue looks on the hands is really kind of cool. So I think in the future for something else, I might make my own gloves like
Are you a
that.
Joss Whedon fan?
No, I don't even know who that
Okay,
is.
the blue hands there reminded me. That's a reference for like two people in the audience. Now, see, you mentioned it, so and a bunch of other people are asking about it, about printing. How do you output?
I print everything here in my studio on an Epson printer that I have a couple different ones, but my favorite one right now is a 9890, and so it can print up to, what, 42-inch wide images, 44, 42-inch rolls of paper. And I like the idea that I can print everything myself because I change my mind all the time. So, I'll make a test print, and then I'll make like 40 test prints before I know it. I'm still making changes and stuff.
So like even for like a museum or whatever, it still comes off your Epson?
Yes, everything is from my Epson. And they're on a matte surface paper that's this nice Canson paper that's called Rag Photographique. It's quite similar to some of the Epson papers also, but or similar to Hahnemühle Photo Rag too. So yeah, I print everything here, and then that way I have control over them.
But I have to guess, just because you're you, that you've got like technicians from Epson in every month to look at your printer or whatever.
Well, no, only if it breaks. I hope not.
I mean, you don't get people sending, you know, here, let us use our super calibrated monitor or use our super whoop-de-doo platinum printing process or whatever?
You know, I have only participated very little in all that kind of world in my career, because partly I just want to use the things that I like, you know. I don't want to feel beholden to people, and I don't want to feel that I must use a certain product. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I try to just use things that I really like and that work for me.
Okay.
So, you know, that's fine. From time to time, if someone wants to send me something free, it's fine. all you tablet people listening out there.
I have tried. So, I mean, of course, now that you say something, you'll get a pallet full of tablets. But I've put out the plea, I don't know how many times, to have a sponsor or an advertiser for the show or whatever. Maybe we can get your paper people or something like that. I don't know. But so far, that my pleas have fallen on deaf ears.
Yeah, I mean, what I do is fairly small time. I mean, in terms of, I don't go out and teach a lot. I don't influence a ton of people in terms of what products they're going to choose. You know, I just do my own thing here, and I love doing it. So that's good for me, you know.
Now, there has to be a little bit more to it, because, I mean, everybody in our audience could pretty much say the same thing, but their stuff is not hanging in museums or whatever. Do you have a promotional team or something like along those lines?
Just me, myself, and I.
You don't even use an agent or anything?
No, Jerry and I both just work by ourselves. We don't have an assistant or any other person
wow.
at all. Like Jerry mats all of his own prints, and I do all mine, and he does the shipping, and I do the scanning. And if we have to send something for PR to a gallery or something, I scan his work or my work. You know, I send things out like that. But it's just us. And we've just found over time that we like it that way. It's our own little cottage industry, and we're not interrupted, and we can work at our own pace, kind of, you know?
So if you get your stuff hanging on a gallery in Santa Fe or whatever, it is just there because of pure raw talent, not because you've got somebody beating the street in your behalf.
And, yeah, it's just there because I got it ready, and Jerry packaged it up, and we sent it there.
Marvelous.
But, you know, making art is a solitary pursuit, really. I mean, it's something that we like doing. In our case, we both like doing it because we like being alone and working on something. And if you have a lot of interruptions and other people that you have to interact with, it takes away from your creative studio time.
Now, did I see somewhere, I know I saw it somewhere, but I'm a little gun-shy because I saw some other stuff somewhere that you said was inaccurate, that you allocate like 10% of your time for commercial work?
Yeah, I mean, I don't allocate it per se, but I was
just the way it went,
just
the way,
looking back
the way
over
it works
the last
out.
Yeah. Like about, you know, a couple times a year somebody will say, oh, could you consider doing this or that for a book or a CD cover or something? And then sometimes I will do that, but not too often, you know, because it's time-consuming, and then you're entering another whole realm where you've got someone else telling you what they want,
sure.
And I just don't work well with others, you know?
Well, you're working really well with us. So you would consider art your full-time job?
Yeah, totally. Like, that's what I do all the time.
Marvelous. Marvelous. Do you have other things that you want to show us today, or should we get into answering audience questions?
I don't have anything else that I'm dying to show you, and I don't want to go too overtime. So, no, you can do whatever
you want.
Well,
from this point forward, we are in your generosity. We can be here as little or as long as you feel like putting up with us.
Okay.
Let's see here. I'll just do these. I'm just going to read a good. I got so many of them. I'm just going to read them in kind of random fashion. Michael wants to know, do you file proper copyright for your finished works?
Yeah, I do. At the end of every year, I usually do that with the Library of Congress thing. It's always a pain. I hate all that paperwork, but I do
it.
So
you don't have an agent, but you do have a lawyer?
You can file them yourself.
Okay.
The copyright stuff? Yeah, it's not that hard. You just have to go onto the U.S. copyright government information pages and download the stuff and do it.
Oh, nobody asked this. This is for me. Do you use any filters? Do you have any filters you like?
I don't have anything that's not already in Photoshop. Mm-hmm. And so within Photoshop, generally the only filters that I really like are, well, the various blur, you know, if I needed like a motion blur for something, or, you know, I'll use some of the different blurs. And sometimes I add noise to something. If I've had to paint something in and I want to make it look a little better, I'll add a little noise. But otherwise, no, I don't use a whole lot. At the very end, when I'm making a large print, I use Smart Sharpen, but otherwise, no.
Okay. Let's see here. I want to give credit here. Randy wants to know, he says, a lot of people copy your style. What do you think about that?
Well, you know, I don't think they would make the exact same thing that I do. And so, you know, there's a lot of people using Photoshop and a lot of people using old photographs and coloring things, and that's fine. Let them do it.
But
I can't worry about that.
I mean, even I am guilty of sitting down and trying for the Maggie Taylor look.
That's fine. I don't mind. I mean, I didn't think I was the only person ever. I mean, there were people before me using photographs of, you know, 19th century people in their work. So everybody has their own separate aesthetic and their own separate color space.
Yeah, but yours jumps out. We could always pick out your work. And I mean, even if it was people deliberately using the same materials or whatever, yours still jumps out.
Yeah. Well, you know, even if I, you know, let's say I gave 10 images of mine to people to make something with in a workshop, for example, which I've done in the past, nobody makes the same thing. If you give somebody, you know, a whole bunch of originals, nobody's going to make the exact same thing. It just doesn't work, you know? So I say let people do it.
Sue has an interesting question. She says, what do you want the viewer to experience when looking at your art?
Well, I don't want it to be an instructive experience. I want it to be a more poetic experience. I guess my goal is that it should be something where every viewer gets a slightly different flavor from the image, or every viewer gets a slightly different, some dredging up of their own memories and storytelling kind of things, if that makes sense.
But
I don't want everybody to get the same experience.
You're like to trigger their imagination or whatever.
Yes.
I mean, there's never like, you know, you're not saying this image I want to be angst, or this image I want to be solve world hunger or anything like that.
No,
okay.
No.
Just whatever you bring to it, that's fine by you.
They're very open-ended.
Let's see here. Several people have asked variations on a theme. I will summarize as to, we want to be you and do what you do. How do we start? Not necessarily Maggie Taylor, but we will
get up and have a cup of coffee every morning and go sit at your computer all day long.
We want to be a fine artist. What would you, if somebody had that aspiration, if you were talking to the you back in the 80s or whatever, what would you?
Well, I did the thing that they told us to do in graduate school, and I suppose that's still what they tell people is, it's about getting your work out there and networking and getting work seen in juried shows and eventually, you know, sending things off. I mean, it used to be slides that we sent off everywhere, but now, of course, it's all digital and online. But entering competitions and going to portfolio review things actually worked for me. And I went to the very early days of Houston Photo Fest when they had the meeting place, which they still have, but it's grown to be a much bigger event every year or every other year now. I forget how often they have Photo Fest. But I went with the portfolio and met with different curators and asked if people were interested in showing the work. And, you know, little by little it would trickle out and I'd get a show at a university gallery here or there. Or eventually, got a show in the Gainesville Regional Airport. That was a big thrill. But, you know, just getting stuff out there. And then, you know, someone who would see it or would be another artist in the same gallery or that I would meet at an opening would say, you know, let me tell my gallery about your work and that kind of thing. So there was a certain element of networking.
Okay.
And, of course, I have to admit it didn't hurt being married to someone like Jerry Yulson.
I promised myself I wasn't going to bring that up.
Yeah, right. But, you know, his work is so different and is pretty much in the purely photographic gallery.
Well, since you brought it up, I got to say – Jerry Huelsman is the reason I got into photography, period.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Wow.
I mean, I knew about him back in the 70s, maybe even earlier, whatever. But his images got me, you know, that's what got me into darkroom to begin with. And a lot of people consider him the spiritual father of Photoshop.
Yes. I think he considers himself that some days. he's so helpful. He does not use Photoshop for anything. He doesn't even know the tool palette. But he knows what it can do, and he can come and sit over here when I'm working on something and say, get that box and put it around her and pull in that corner like you do. You know, get that, make her be a little bit smaller, make her be a little bit bigger, or can you do that thing you do with the gradient thing or something. So he knows what it can do, and he has the best eye for how to put something together, you know, after all of his years of putting things together in the darkroom. So, but he doesn't actually use it.
Marvelous. I have to pardon me for being enthralled here, but I'm getting at least as big a thrill out of this as anybody in the audience is right now. I don't even know what this question means, but Allison asks, how were your images selected for a Ghost Whisperer?
Oh, well, that was those images already existed, and the Ghost Whisperer people asked me if someone who worked on their title sequence.
Is this the TV show?
For the TV show.
I don't watch it, but so okay.
Oh, well, maybe you're just not a fan of Jennifer Love Hewitt. But so this was a TV show a number of years ago, and they were a lot of times for television shows, they'll have a whole separate production company that does the title sequence, and people are very artistic with those. So, you know, an art director contacted me and said, we want to use these 10 or 12 images and license them to make our own animated version of the titles for this TV show. And so they picked which images, and we negotiated a price, and they did that. And so it's been seen a lot. I mean, it's actually in other countries, in syndication, even in Italy and other places I know. So it gets a lot of exposure. You'd have to look really carefully to see my name or find out who did the images if you were just randomly looking at the TV show. So it was kind of a strange experience, but it did get the work out there. But none of them were made specifically for them. They actually were images that already existed, and they kind of just wrote them into their story.
No specifics, please, but does something like that pay well?
Sometimes yes, but you have to be really careful about the negotiations. And I've learned over time. Every time I've done anything like that, I realize the mistakes I've made, and next time I try to do it a little better.
Somebody did ask, and I apologies to them because it's already scrolled up, and so I can't find the name real fast, but somebody did ask is how whatever venue you are aiming at, how do you go about pricing your work?
Well, I mean, if you were just starting out, I would say you should find a gallery that looks like the type of gallery that would show your work, that shows comparable people that have similar experience, mm-hmm. maybe, and similar style of work, and see what kind of prices they have. Mm-hmm. And if you have friends that are artists that are selling their work, see what kind of prices they mm-hmm. have. And I mean, you can find so much these days on the Internet in terms of prices of work on all these different
websites.
What
about you? Is that just like whatever the market will bear?
Oh, yeah. I mean, basically, you can't go backwards again. So if you raise the prices, you're never going to go back down lower than that.
That's actually very good advice, especially for a site called RetouchPRO.com. That actually, you know, underscores something, a point that I try to make. It is very true. Don't ever go back.
Yeah. So, you know, gradually over time, people expect you to raise them a little bit, I suppose. So every once in a while. And also, if an image sells out, like within a year, I've had some images, one or two images a year, it seems like, will sell out within a year, and I make editions of each one, you know, in a couple different sizes.
Do you do the signing and numbering thing?
Yes, I do. And it makes me sad when I don't have any more of something. I mean, on the one hand, it makes me happy because I sold it, but it makes me sad because then I don't have any more of that image.
Send them
a
magnet.
So then I would raise the price because I think if you're really... if things are selling that quickly, the market would probably let you charge a little bit more, you know.
Renee wants to know if you've ever been contacted by somebody that knew somebody in one of your pictures.
No. One time someone wrote me and said, I think that's my grandmother in your image. And it's like, well, if so, I'd like to see what image you have of her because it's a daguerreotype that I have from like 1860, and I think it's the only one.
Great.
Yeah.
Now, Stephen brings up an interesting point. I don't know if it's a little technical, but I would like it if you could go into it a little bit. He says, how do you match the sharpening from a sharp fern to a soft daguerreotype? So you've got a scan of a real-life object, or maybe even a photo of a real-life object. So that's going to be with modern optics and the best, you know, the best technology Epson can bring to things. And then you've got this 150-year-old daguerreotype that is, you know, maybe 150 DPI, probably 75. And then you have to match the way they look together in a pleasing way. Do you have a technique for this?
Yeah, basically what I do, and I can show it in this image, is the scans of the ferns are just straight sharp scans, but then over the top of them and over the top of everything, I'll usually put another layer that's just a texture. So I've got the arms and the face, and all these things are from slightly different sources, you know, and then I've put textures on them. So the textures a lot of times are from old photographs. That shows, that's just a scan of, I mean, that's just a photograph of my arms there. Those are just basic. If I actually open the thing so you can see what the arms look like, that's just my arms outside, like just straight, ugly, regular photograph, right? So then I've got to add textures over that. So I take bits and pieces of things. I might even cut out a bit of the background of an old photograph like this that had a certain dappled quality and try making the layers cut out to be the same size as the arms, have different, like there's a multiply layer at 25% there. If I darken it way down, you'll see more what it is. It's like a speckly bad thing from the back of a photograph. But by the time you lighten it up, it just kind of helps blend it all together. And so sometimes I'll put a layer like that over the whole image. Sometimes I'll put it over just the figure or the ferns. And I often find that overlay is a great blend mode for it. So if I put this now, like for example, this layer, if I put it on normal, you see it's just a crackledy, speckledy thing from an old photograph. And it covers the whole woman and every single fern there. And it's made from the background of this original photograph.
There you go.
It doesn't have to be from this photograph. It could be from any photograph. It just has to have a certain quality to the texture. And then I didn't want so much on her face, so I made a mask so that it would let her face be a little clearer and a little, because when it was all on her face, it was a little too much. Mm-hmm. And then I made it as a, what was it? Oh, not multiply. Sometimes multiply is good, but this was overlay. And then I lighten it up just a little because you don't want too much. And then I put on the mask. So that's what I usually take something that's a plain background. So even if I'm buying stuff at a flea market, if I don't like the actual image itself, I might buy it for the texture. I might buy it for what else is in the image, you know?
Well, fascinating.
Yeah, or I photographed painter's drop cloths before and other crackle texture things, too, can do that. Yeah.
Feather wants to know, what artists inspire you?
I like a lot of painting, but, you know, like if I'm in New York and I go to the Met and look around, I like to look at, like, the Flemish, Netherlands sort of paintings from the, you know, 1500s, because they just have these wonderful individuals with quirky light and symbolic objects with them in brilliant colors, like jewel tones. Mm-hmm. I like old things like that. I don't look at a whole lot of contemporary art, honestly. Mm-hmm. Once in a while, I'll thumb through a magazine or something, but I like to look at Magritte. I like to look at surrealist art. I was in Belgium a couple of years ago. I went to the Magritte Museum, which was a kind of magical, wonderful experience.
Had you pegged as a Dada fan?
Yeah, I sort of like Dada, but it's a little too more off the wall for me.
Really, off the wall for you?
I get inspired by nature, and I like being outdoors and being like hiking or on the water or gardening in my yard and finding stuff, you know? So sometimes I collect things just with my point-and-shoot camera just because it's a beautiful sunset or they're nice clouds.
You ever scanned, like, bugs and worms and stuff, anything alive like that?
Bugs, yes, not worms. Bugs, yes.
You mentioned the gardening. The first thing, whenever I think about, at least in my garden, is all the worms and grubs and stuff. So.
Yeah, you never know. That's what I like about that, is that it's sort of random what you'll find, you know?
Joni asked a question. I will be astounded if there is an answer to this, but it would also be wonderful. She wants to know, do you have a favorite image of yours?
Well, I mean, I have two sort of favorites, I guess. One would be, there was an image a long time ago that was a girl with a bee dress from 2004 that sold out a long time ago, and I don't know whether I partly like it because it did so well or whether I just like it because it was sort of an unusual image for me, but I do like that girl with the bee dress. And I also like the most recent ones that I've been working on. Like my real favorite usually is whatever I'm just working
on.
Because that's like, once you're done working on something and you send it off, you kind of no longer connect with it as much, you know? Let me see. If you've just sent something off, it's like, you've said goodbye to it and it's on its own kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Whereas if it's, I'm just looking to see if I can find what I'm just working on. If it's what you're still struggling with, it's kind of closer to your heart in a certain way. This is my folder of like everything that I'm working on. And this is like, it says I started this folder in 2012 and every year I just add another year to the sequence. But it's like, kind of everything that I'm currently working on. It includes a folder of people, of like, these are all scans made of things recently that I might want to use, but I haven't really used them yet. And so, they're in partial stages of retouching. And some of them are really failed, ugly things that I've just never done anything with. Like this guy, I spent probably a week working on this image, and it's really not to my liking, so I've never done anything with it. But I might use the background sometime, or I might do something else with it, you know. So, but anyway, the basic thing is just whatever I'm currently working on is what I like. And right now, what I'm working on is, what am I working on? I'm working on a boat image that isn't quite finished because I haven't decided for sure if I like the words yet, but it's going to look something like that. Non-watermarked image on the web.
Yes. That actually reminds me of something. That was, the Tim Burton Big Fish movie.
Oh, yeah, I didn't see that movie. I saw a poster
for it. That kind of reminded me of the poster for the big, instead of Well Then, it was Big Fish.
Oh, really?
Sorry.
I vaguely saw that, yeah. I'm working on Through the Looking Glass stuff right now. So I sort of am interested in Alice in Wonderland again. I did this book of Alice in Wonderland that had 45 images in it. And then I stopped because it was just the first 12 chapters, the true Alice in Wonderland, and I didn't do Through the Looking Glass. So I finished all of that project in 2008, and since then I've kind of decided I should go back and work on Through the Looking Glass. So that's kind of what I'm doing now.
Base it on just the text or base it on the original illustrations?
I base it on the text. But because I look at the original illustrations and I look at other people's illustrations and try to make mine be a little bit different and stuff. Mm-hmm. But I basically made a folder for each chapter of the 12 chapters, and then in them I collect stuff that I think might relate, and I start gradually working on images and saving either versions or screenshots of things, you know. So these are like all parts and bits and pieces of things that I want to use for something. But it's been very slow progress because at the same time I still want to have time to do other images that I feel like that are not Alice in Wonderland. So like for me right now, probably my closest favorite image I've been working on is this, which I just am not even 100% finished with, but it's like the walrus and the carpenter for Through the Looking Glass. So I'm still kind of working
on that. That's that same frame shape.
That's the exact frame from that
girl. But here it gives it kind of a Persian Moorish look.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
So, anyway.
Let's see here. Somebody, Sue, wants to know, she says, you seem to include depth in your work. Is that an important principle you use?
Yeah, I definitely want there to be a kind of receding space that draws your eye into the work, if that's what she means.
I think so.
I like the idea that, and I'll, like, for example, if I had an image that didn't have that, what I do to add that in kind of is I make an adjustment layer. I don't know if it'll work all that well here, but just to show you, I'll make a hue and saturation adjustment layer and usually kind of lighten and desaturate and sometimes go a little more bluish with it. And then that adjustment layer, instead of having it affect the whole image, I'll use the gradient tool and make it so that it can only affect a portion of the image. So I'll make it so that it doesn't affect too much at the top of the image, and it doesn't affect too much at the bottom of the image. So then it's really just affecting in the middle of the image like that. See? That's a bad example of it, but it sort of shows that when you turn that on and off, you can kind of see how that adds depth in there.
What about visual elements adding depth? This is a very good image. You know, the deer gets smaller, and then the trees behind that get smaller. Is that something you consciously think about, or is that just that's the way it works out?
Yeah, I do think about that. I mean, I try to pay attention to how things are working in the image. And the nice thing about working in Photoshop is they're all movable. So even if I decided now that I want, like, the entire woman to move, she's basically movable. You know, she can go wherever. She can come out and go in a completely different image, you know, her shadow or whatever. She can go elsewhere. So I leave that as an option, because I might make a print of it like that and decide that's really way too off-center and I don't like it, and then I can move her back.
Karen wants to know if you ever use stock photography for any of your images or elements.
No, I really don't, because I sort of like the idea that I have a personal, emotional attachment to each of the things that I'm using, whether it's from my yard or from my camera. The few times I've done it would be, like I said, like a glass from a website, from Pottery Barn or Crate and Barrel website, where I realize it's a big hassle for me to just photograph a glass. But pretty much, like, if you look in this folder here, these are snapshots from my vacations. And every once in a while, I'll take from a art history type of a website, I'll get a background of a painting, a medieval painting or something, and use it either for the rocks or the textures or the colors or just as a template for some kind of inspiration. But I don't really use stock stuff now.
Do you ever do anything that is fun?
Like what? You mean with my working in Photoshop?
I'm assuming you've got non-Photoshop hobbies or whatever, but I'm talking about in Photoshop. Do you ever do anything just for your own entertainment?
Yeah, I mean, you know, while I'm working, it is sort of for your entertainment. You know, you're working on something, and then you just start clicking layers on and off and making something be completely black and white, or, you know, that's one of the, I mean, I do, and I'll just, like, at the end of the day, if I just, I'm ready to close something and finish working on it, sometimes I'll just say, you know what, I'm going to make an adjustment layer and make the whole thing black and white and just see if I even like it as a black and white image. And that's kind of fun to do.
So you're a true artist. You know? You are doing what you are doing your entertainment for a living.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Basically.
That's very cool. Let's see here. Jane says she finds that many galleries don't know how to classify her work. They don't see it as fine art, but they also don't see it as photography either. How do you argue your case on issues like this?
You know, people always ask me how to categorize my work in terms of is it photography or not, and I've kind of lost interest in that question over the years because there's so many people now working in this same kind of genre. I don't feel like we need to explain. People understand about Photoshop. People understand you can manipulate images. So I don't call it photography, and I don't call it really anything. If people say I have to categorize it, I'll say it's digital art or digital imagery. And I think galleries have become a lot more accepting of it. You just have to find the right gallery. You know, if a gallery tells you we don't want to show digitally manipulated work and you're doing digitally manipulated work, that's not the place for you, you know.
Plus, I guess, you know, it helps that you're, you know, Maggie Taylor.
No, I don't know if that helps.
Trust me, I bet you it does. Diana wants to know, how many images do you actually create in a year?
Very few. I make about 10 or 12 images a year. That's all. Like, I think last year I made a few more maybe, but that's because it was a particularly good year. But I'm really pretty slow, like, really. And part of it is that I travel a fair amount, and so I can't be working and finishing images while I'm traveling. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I was just trying to find for you the folder that has in it everything from last year, for example. Here's 2014 images that are done. And what I do is I save them in the different sizes that I have them, and then I save JPEGs of them and stuff. But so this is every single image that I made last year.
Now, that said 15-inch. Does that mean that these are intended to be printed to 15 inches wide?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, so I keep them in the folders for how much they're printed. So that's everything from last year, though. So I'm not that fast.
Oh,
you know? It's like one image a month.
And like the first question that got asked whenever this webinar first started is, why are your images all square?
I just like a square. I don't know why. And I think part of it has to do with the real estate. When you're working with things in Photoshop, this is only one of my two screens that you're seeing here. So, but the space that you have here is basically square when you have your palettes over there. I have a second screen that you don't see that has all my other palettes on it. And usually when I'm working, I keep a second copy of the image open over on that other screen too. And I black out everything in the background so I just have the images showing. Like not the total blackout like that, but I do just leave it like that. So I think over time I've just fallen in love with that square format, and then it's hard for me to find a reason to move away from that.
So like whenever you were working with actual silver film, did you also work in a square?
No, I didn't. I worked 4x5, so I worked with a very sort of stubby rectangle.
Okay, so but you were not like a Hassie user or a Rolleiflex or whatever?
No, never.
Let's see here. Andy wants to...
How many more questions do we do?
I'm just going until you say you got to go.
Oh, God. We might be here all night.
We could wrap this up.
5:30. It's almost wine time.
Okay, good. This is such a rare privilege, and I'm just grooving on looking at your images.
Do like two more or something, and then that'll be good.
Oh, now you've put the pressure on. Now we got to get the good questions.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Okay, here's a nice inspirational one. Rachel wants to know, what gets you inspired?
One thing for sure that I get inspired by is when I go to a really good flea market. And there are a few around Atlanta and Central Florida a couple times a year. There's one in Mount Dora, Florida that I really love. Like, it's only 3 weekends a year, only in the winter, and I try to put that on my calendar and go there, because just the wandering around and the random finding of things is fun for me. I don't really have in mind, other than, of course, I always like to look at old photographs, but I might find a box of old puppets or dolls, or I might find a weird old set of toy chairs. It's just odds and ends and little things that I bring them home, and I don't really know what I'm going to do with them, but they're fun and they're interesting. I have behind me in my studio right now, I have like a sort of tableau thing I have set up on a dresser kind of thing, where I have a doll's table and a doll and a couple of old paper things I found that works on paper with, like, they're like an autograph book sort of thing from the 1800s. And I love these things, and I look at them every day, and I never know at what point they might actually turn into an image, you know?
Do you ever throw stuff out?
Yeah, sometimes I'll do a big cleanup and get rid of things.
Maggie?
If I open up a box with insects in it that's been there for a year or so, like dragonflies that I found dead outside, and I open it and it smells, then I would throw them
away. Maggie Taylor garage sale this weekend.
Yeah. And I heart, like, this is an example of a, this is an image that I hated the subject in it, but I sort of like the background and I like these trees. So I just went ahead and cloned out the lady that was sitting on this little stool, and I could use this as a part of a background or a texture to go over something at some point.
Marvelous. Well, thank you so much, Maggie. It has been such a treat to have you here today, and you've been so generous, not only showing us how you work, but also showing us your folders and things along those lines. That has been very valuable. I hope you enjoyed being here with us today.
It was fun.
Certainly, it was different. How's that? Well,
yes. It was a new experience for me.
Excellent, excellent. Well, thank you again. I want to remind everybody, this show will be up on YouTube tomorrow, so tell all your friends about it. Go to RetouchPRO.com. If you're not already a member, register there. You'll get notified for all the future shows. Please consider becoming a patron if you want to keep this engine running. That is how we keep it fueled. Check out our rental videos as well. Okay. Well, thanks everybody for being here. I will see you in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, Maggie.
Bye.